Welcome back to True Believers and the Road to Hell. We're here with Raymond Sanchez, who has some fascinating perspectives on a lot of issues in New Mexico, and he's obviously quite passionate about a lot of these issues. And Raymond, thanks again for being with us.
Glad to do it.
I wanted to ask you about the present. I know you're not in the legislature anymore, and you're not the president of Regents anymore. You are practicing law, as I understand. I'm just wondering, what is it that drives you these days, and what is it that what are your aspirations going forward?
What drives me these days is just to stay in good health and be able to get from one point to the next, Michael.
It's minute by minute, right?
You know, I grew up, I was a very, very active individual. I mean, I got involved in sports all the time. I wasn't all that great when I was in high school. My brother was. He was really a phenomenal athlete and just a tremendous person.
You're talking about Michael.
Yeah, my brother Michael Sanchez. Yeah,
who also, by the way, we won't take a lot of time on it, but Michael should be recognized also as a political powerhouse.
Phenomenal job while he was in the state senate. It was a real shame that he didn't get reelected. I think he's a lot happier for it. But you know,
maybe I'll talk to him on this on day, but he needs.
Yeah,
to
what drives me though, Michael, is I was very active and I want to stay active physically and mentally. I wish I had more time to get involved again in some of the things that I had been involved in before. That's why I enjoy serving on the Public Defender Commission. I think it's something where I can contribute. And, you know, I'll be off that any day now, for that matter.
You will.
I'm serving a term that's pretty much expired, waiting until they replace me. But I want to stay active mentally, and I wish I could stay active physically. Unfortunately, I can't play handball like I used to.
Tell us about the handball. You used to be a very active.
Oh, I played handball all over the United States. I loved the game. It was something that kept me in shape. It was a way to vent my frustrations while I was in the legislature. Believe me, and even as a lawyer, just getting out in the afternoon and banging that handball around and pounding it, and just it was a way to. It really was. It's just everybody.
It's a great game for one thing.
Anytime you get physical exercise, my aspirations today are to continue to be a voice for those who don't have a voice. That's why I continue to practice law. I don't do as much as I used to do. In fact, I haven't had a jury trial in longer than I care to admit. A lot of my practice is now limited mostly to commercial stuff. I do some personal injury and I enjoy it because it helps people. But I want to stay committed to helping the community. And to be quite frank, I'm trying to find a place to land after this Public Defender Commission. And I'm seriously considering doing something with the university, maybe going on the Alumni Association, doing stuff there.
Well, I know that you have been and you've been very active in, you were a member of Sigma Chi fraternity, and you got recognized. I saw that you were given the what is called the Significant Sig Award, which is a big award within the fraternity. And so I think you've followed up with the Alumni Association and so forth. And I know you've been very active with that. You've developed a lot of relationships through that. But I wonder what it brings to mind a question. What do you think about the relevance of that these days? Fraternity, you know, the Greek system, of course, has come under scrutiny for years. And I don't know what are your thoughts about it today, as opposed to, you know, back when they used to have Hell Weeks and and you know, in college.
Well, those hell weeks are over, fortunately. But, you know, I attribute a lot of what I am today to a lot of factors and a lot of people. But one of the things that really influenced me was belonging to Sigma Chi. The men and women I met from all over the state, I developed some friendships that will last forever. One of my closest, dearest friends is someone from Carlsbad, and I used to be from Artesia, Mike Currier.
Yep.
He was a Sigma Chi. And
friend of mine, you know, also.
We came from different parts of the state. And when we first met, of course, we'd met when we were in high school at student council meetings. And we were always, it was kind of like, who could do this better than the other? It was kind of a weird relationship. And when he played Sigma Chi, he got scared when he found out I was inactive. And we went one day up to the dry waterfall and we had a beer bust. And he and I drank enough beer to last us a lifetime. It created a lifetime of a friendship because my dad had always taught me, sin hablar no se entiende. If you don't talk to one another, how can you ever understand one another? And he and I carried on a conversation, and I learned things about him and he learned things about me. You know, I'd always assumed, coming from where you are, Mike, you probably didn't like somebody with an Hispanic surname. And coming from where I came from, I didn't trust people from your part of the state. But we created a bond that was unbreakable, and it's unbreakable to this day. But I learned a big lesson. You really need to get to know people. Again, going back to what I said about the restaurant, you get to need to know them. And then you find out that, my God, you have more in common than you don't. And that was quite an experience for me. And there were a lot of men who were in that fraternity who were from the Carlsbad area, Artesia area. And they became my friends also. And yes, that was a good time for me. It was important. Another organization that I belonged to that I became president of actually was the National Association of Latino Elected Officials. And I was the first vice chairman. In fact, I was a founder of that organization. And I served as vice chairman for years. And then when the president decided he was going to resign, he wanted me to take over, and I did. And I met people from all over the United States, men and women who just were fabulous, fabulous individuals, who probably, but for that organization, would not have grown the wings to take over in many, many jurisdictions and get elected as Hispanics or Latinos or whatever we call them. I heard somebody refer to us now as Latinx or something. Never quite heard that term, and I'm not sure what it means.
You get to decide, you know.
I guess somebody gets to decide.
You know, nobody else decides what you.
I'm not sure what that is or what it means. But the fact of the matter is, there are a lot of people with surnames, which are Hispanic, who are now holding positions all over. When I first got elected in 1970, I was in L.A. I was called to a group of guys, asked me if I'd go down there to talk to them, 1973. They wanted to know how it was that we had so many Hispanics in New Mexico that were in prominent positions. I'll never forget, we're sitting in this restaurant and bar, and I looked at there were about five of them. I says, that's because we go out and we run for office. And they looked at me and they said, yeah, but we're in California. I said, what's the difference? You guys need to go out and run for office. You need to start getting your people elected. They had nobody in California. They had three or four Hispanics in the whole state. They had a congressman, but that was it. And we talked for 2 days. We spent just strategizing. And I was so shocked. Texas was the same way. Arizona, of course, is almost the same way to this day. But people need to get out and let them know who you are. You can't be afraid to go out and knock on doors and let people see you in the flesh. And I told him that. You just can't. You've got to do it. You've got to be able to just step up. And of course, we had an advantage in New Mexico because, hey, we've always been part of the political process, going back to statehood. So it was we had a leg up.
Just about every comment you've made today comes back to these relationships, it seems to me, that you have developed, and you have really, really strong relationships, and that's very, very admirable. So I really applaud you for having.
Well, it's like you and I, Mike. You become my friend over the years. I mean, I didn't know you, and today we're here talking about things that are pretty sensitive, and we're being open with one another. Who would have thought that 20 years ago? Really?
Yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah. I appreciate it. I appreciate you calling me your friend.
You are my friend.
Yeah, I am your friend. Let me talk about a somewhat sensitive topic, I guess, is that you mentioned earlier that you are presently lobbying. And, you know, I think the public, I'd like to know what the public doesn't understand about that, because it seems to me that the word lobbyist is like a pejorative. It's like, you know, it's like seen as an insult, you know, because you'll see in political ads about, oh, the lobbyists do this or the lobbyists do that, or he's a friend of the law. When in fact, we all know that really lobbying is just a way of exercising First Amendment rights, basically. And anyway, so I'm wondering, what do you think the public doesn't understand about lobbyists?
Well, I think every industry and every idea has a right to be expressed. And you said it earlier, you know, constitutional right to express your opinion and be able to share it. Yeah, we can talk about lobbyists. I look at more as advocacy. We're advocating for a certain position. Lobbyists or advocates, whichever you want to call us, are people who have developed relationships. I don't think that people understand that here in New Mexico, because we are still such a small colloquial state, that we get to know so many people that the friendships we've developed over the years somehow allow us access. But it allows us access only in the sense that people will listen to us. And I've always felt that all I want from a legislator is that he or she will allow me the opportunity to tell them why I am advocating for this industry or this group. And that's what I want, just to be able to let them know. And you don't ever expect them to vote for your position, but you would expect them to have an open mind and listen to you. And the first thing you can't do is ever tell them a lie, and you can never mislead them. You've got to tell them, here's the good side of my position, and here's the other side that may affect your election. And you give them both sides and let them make up their mind. And I used to appreciate that most when I was in the legislature, when someone came to me with a proposition, just, okay, you've told me what you want, now tell me the bad side of this thing. Tell me the other side. And many times there wasn't another side, but when there was, I'd tell you. And I really appreciated that. To give
isn't
me a
the problem? I'm sorry. Isn't part of the perception problem anyway? Is that I suppose someone will say, "Well, okay, fine. You're having your voice heard and so forth, but you're getting paid to give that particular opinion." Someone might say, "You're a registered lobbyist who gets paid by an industry to espouse a particular position," and so that. That makes it more more complicated, I guess I would say.
Well, I think everybody if you're going to perform a job, you ought to get compensated, number
one.
Well,
but I go to the legislature and I express my opinion and no one pays me to do that. They might not like,
yeah, I'm not like sure that's opinion. True, though. You know, those advocates who go up there who aren't paid have as much influence, if not more, in many instances, than someone who, an advocate who is paid. And it's hard to do that. You know, and people say that money plays a big role in this. I mean, if a $250 contribution to a candidate is going to influence them,
they're not much of a candidate.
You got a real problem.
Right.
That's not happening. And, you know, that's the other side of that coin, contributing to candidates for office. I mean, they have a right to be able to raise money so they can express their views too. So it's, you know, it's a interesting dynamic. I like the dynamic. I'm not going to be doing this much longer, but while I do it, I want to be respected, and I will respect the person who I deal with. I will never, ever tell a person they've got to do this. All I will ask them to is listen to me, and hopefully they'll accept my viewpoint. If they can't, hey, let's remain friends and move on. I'm not going to hold it against you if you vote against my bill. I won't take it personally. If I start taking it personally, you'd lost
a long time ago.
Oh,
so let me finish up here by asking you to, you've got so much valuable experience, Raymond, over the years in all of these different areas. And two come to mind. One is the legal area, that you've been a lawyer all these years. And the other is the political arena that you've been involved in, as you've discussed. I'm just wondering if some young person who's thinking about getting into these areas says, well, Raymond, God, what's the one lesson I need to learn? I have a suspicion I might know what it comes back to, given everything you've talked about here today. But what is your simplest, kind of most straightforward advice you'd give either a young lawyer or a young politician?
It's to have an open mind. Just and be willing to make friends before you make enemies. You know, develop relationships. Have an open mind. Understand the other person's perspective. Try to convince them that yours is right. But if you can't, don't take it personally. Shake hands, become friends, walk off and go get a beer. Sit down and enjoy it. And really just make friends. I'd rather have a friend any day of my life than to create an enemy over an issue. It just doesn't make any sense otherwise. And today, too many people they haven't made friends yet. And they're too busy debating issues to make a friendship out of their neighbor. And that's a big problem.
Well, you've demonstrated here today, Raymond, and you've demonstrated here today just how or why you have so many friends and how you've developed so many friends with good relationships over the years throughout New Mexico and throughout the nation. And I appreciate you talking with us about your sage advice and your perspective.
I'm not sure about sage advice.
Well, we don't agree on everything, but of course nobody does. But I appreciate your passion and your perspective and your wisdom. And so thank you very much for giving us your time on True Believers and the Road to Hell.
I'm more than happy to. And if you get a chance and you see my really, really good friend, Joni Gutierrez, give her a hug and a kiss for me. I think she's getting much better. And if she's watching this by any odd quirk of fate, Joni, get well, honey. We miss you.
We can send it to her if personally. That's no problem. Thank you, Raymond.
Okay. Thank you, Mike. Take care of yourself, brother.
Thank you.